In this video, we are going to derive the transfer function that relates the angular displacement to the applied armature voltage for the DC motor model. Here's our DC motor model. Recall that E sub A is the applied armature voltage. R sub A is the winding resistance or the armature resistance. L sub A, because we have windings and coils of wire, is our winding inductance in our armature. V sub B is the back EMF that the motor derives as it starts to spin, and it was due to Faraday's law, and it's equal to the motor constant K sub B times the angular rate of rotation of this motor shaft, omega m. And recall that omega m is equal to the derivative of the angular displacement of the shaft as a function of time. And finally, the torque the motor derives, and again, I'll show the torque over here, T sub m, is equal to K sub T times the winding current, or the current through the windings. And that came from Lenz's law of force. Typically, the motor is going to be attached to some mechanical load, and that mechanical load will have a rotational inertia, J sub L, and there may be rotational friction on this mechanical load, and I'll show it as a dashpot, D sub L. The motor itself, the armature of the motor, is going to have its rotational mass, J sub A, and will also have some friction in the motor, which I label as D sub A. Therefore, the total motor rotational inertia that the electric motor experienced, J sub M, is due to its armature plus the applied load rotational inertia. Likewise, the total frictional coefficient for the motor is due to the friction in the armature as well as any friction on the load. We can now derive an electrical equation for the motor, and then we're going to derive the mechanical equations, and these two sets of equations will allow us to obtain the transfer function for the DC motor. Let's obtain the electrical equations for our motor. We can do KVL around this loop, and we see that EA minus the voltage drop across the winding resistance minus the voltage drop across the inductance, and recall the voltage drop across an inductor is VL is equal to LdI dt. Minus the back EMF is all equal to zero. I'm going to rearrange this equation, and we have EA is equal to IA times RA minus LA times DI dt. Plus VB. We can now do the Laplace transform, and we obtain EAS is equal to IA as a function of S, RA, plus SLA times IA of S, plus VB of S. But note that the torque is related to the current through the following equations. I can do the Laplace transform of both sides of that equation to obtain an equation for the Laplace transform of the current, IA of S, and that is equal to the Laplace transform of the torque divided by the torque constant, K sub T. And likewise, the back EMF is equal to the motor constant KB times the Laplace transform of the angular velocity, which I'll write in form of the angular displacement. We can now substitute these two equations into our equation, and we obtain EA of S is equal to Tm of s times Ra over kt plus Tm of s times Sla over kt plus Kbs theta m of s. Here's our equation for the electrical portion in terms of the angular displacement and the torque that the motor applies. We can resolve this equation by looking at the mechanical equations. So now let's look at the mechanical equations and recall that the total inertial mass that the motor experiences, J sub m, is equal to JA plus JL, and dm is equal to dA plus dL, and the motor is going to apply a torque T sub m to that total load the motor experiences. We can do a free body diagram on this rotor, and I'm going to do our free body diagram directly in the Laplace domain. We have an applied torque Tm of s. We have a counter torque due to the rotational mass, Jm s squared theta m of s, and we have a counter torque due to the friction, dm s theta m of s. This results in the following equation. The torque is equal to Jm s squared plus dm s all times theta m of s. We now have an equation that relates the torque to the angular displacement, which we can use in our electrical equation. And here I've tidied up the electrical equation. And we're going to now substitute our torque equation into the electrical equation. And that provides us with Ea is equal to Ra over kt plus La over kt s times Jm s squared plus dm s all times theta m of s plus kb s theta m of s. We can factor out a theta m from the right-hand side of this equation. One of the things you may notice is we have a third order system. It is common practice with the motor models to ignore the inductance LA because LA is much, much smaller than RA, and therefore its term and effect on the startup properties of the DC motor are somewhat negligible. They're there, but they're not that important, and the transient effect it causes is so quickly, it goes away very fast. And so oftentimes we ignore this term and we let LA equal to zero. So let's look at that situation where LA equals zero. Here we show the equation that's tidied up and we have LA set equal to zero. And we'll notice this is a second order equation. We can rearrange it a little bit more. Let's combine terms of S in this equation, and we see we have Ra Jm over kt S squared plus Ra dm over kt S plus kbs all times theta m of s, or RAJM over KT S squared plus RADM over KT plus KB times S. And now we are set to write this in terms of theta M over EA is equal to 1 over, let me take an S out of this equation, S times RAJM over KTS plus RADM over KT plus KB. Now, as you know, we typically want to clear this leading coefficient. Therefore, we're going to multiply both top and bottom of this equation by KT over RA times JM. Again, we're going to multiply by KT over RA times JM. And this is the equation we obtain when we do that. Here we see that we've cleared that coefficient out, and we're left with this term. This has the form of A over S times S plus A. And this should look very familiar. This little A acts like our time constant, where A is equal to 1 over tau for a first order system. Therefore, that should be an M right there. Therefore, our tau for our DC motor is equal to 1 over this term. Likewise, if we wanted to find the angular velocity as a function of the applied voltage, we could multiply both left-hand and right-hand sides of this equation by S, and that would obtain I strongly encourage you to write both of these equations down in your notes and have them ready to go. We're going to use these often in the remainder of this course, as well as in a control systems course when we look at controlling a motor. So just to wrap up this video, we looked at the DC motor model and we derived the electrical equations. And we derive the mechanical equations. And we combine them together, we obtained an equation that related the angular velocity to the applied armature voltage, which was equal to KT over RAJM divided by S plus 1 over JM times the quantity DM plus KT KB all over RA. Thank you for watching.